Hello, everyone, and welcome to day three of MinnPost Festival and our conversation with Margaret Sullivan. My name is Tanner Curl. I'm the executive director of MinnPost. We're a nonprofit independent newsroom serving Minnesotans with in-depth coverage of civic and cultural life. I'm very excited to welcome Margaret Sullivan to the festival, and I'll be moderating the conversation, so it's an honor for me. But first, I want to thank our festival sponsors, Minneapolis Foundation, the Shavlik Family Foundation, as well as our supporting sponsors, Accredited Investors Wealth Management, Darla Cashin at RBC Wealth Management, Polad Companies, Quincy Hall, St. Paul and Minnesota Foundation, and UCare, as well as our promoting sponsors, At Sarah's Table, Chester Creek Cafe in Duluth, Baird Private Wealth Management, Frederickson and Byron, PA, the Hubbard School of Journalism and Mass Communication at the University of Minnesota, the Humphrey School of Public Affairs at the University of Minnesota, and Knock, Inc. Thanks to all of our sponsors. I also want to thank Joel and Lori Kramer, executive presenters for the festival, as well as all of our generous VIP supporters. The support is very imperative for MinnPost, and I encourage you to check out the list of our VIP supporters at minnpost.com/festival. I also want to thank our over 5,500 MinnPost members. You can join this generous and amazing group of people by making a donation of any amount at minnpost.com/support. Your tax-deductible donation in any amount is really crucial to our work and allows us to make all of our reporting available to all readers for free, no paywall. Again, you can make your donation at minnpost.com/support, and thank you. You can submit questions during this session. You do it by clicking on the Q&A button at the bottom of your window. Click the button, a window pops up, and you can type in your question and submit it. We'll be taking your questions later on in the session. You can submit them at any point. Just click that button at the bottom of your window to do so. And with that, I would like to welcome Margaret Sullivan into the Zoom to join us for this conversation. Margaret, we're really honored to have you here with us today. Just as a little bit of bio, you're currently the media columnist at the Washington Post. Prior to that, the public editor of the New York Times. And prior to that, you had a 32-year career at the Buffalo News, starting as an intern all the way up to the top editor role. So I guess to kind of really jump right in, because I got a lot of questions for you. I want to make sure we make good use of time. Can you kind of talk about that, you know, the arc of, you know, just even in your time working in local journalism, it changed a lot. What were the big impacts? What were the challenges?
Well, first of all, thank you very much, Tanner, and thank you for having me to the festival. I'm a huge fan of MinnPost and, you know, more broadly of nonprofit, digital startup journalism, which is local journalism, which is really, really important today, given everything that's happened. So I'm happy to be a part of your celebration and contribute in this small way towards your work. So thanks for having me. Yeah. Well, I would say that the industry has really transformed almost completely since I began. As you said, it's kind of frightening to hear the numbers of that I've been in the business, but I did start as a mere child, so please take that into account. But, you know, I literally came to the Buffalo News as a college student, and we were working on manual typewriters, and we were actually putting, you know, pieces of carbon paper in between our pieces of copy paper, you know. So it was a really, really long time ago. And the business has completely transformed. You know, now, of course, pretty much every news organization is digital first, some digital only. And those who haven't made the digital transformation are really hurting. So, you know, I guess the biggest thing, and this is no news really to anyone, but just to sort of state the obvious, the way that the newspaper business supported itself and its lifeblood was print advertising. You know, that was the way that the journalism was paid for. and it was about 2/3 to 3/4 of the revenue, total revenue, was print advertising. And the rest of it came from subscriptions or from people buying the paper, so consumer revenue. That was changing radically in the 90s as people sort of got out of the habit of having, you know, reading two newspapers, and one paper would be going out of business, typically in a large city. That was true in Buffalo, where I was, when the Courier Express, which was edited by Joel Kramer, still in the business
here. MinnPost co-founder, yes.
He was the editor of the Courier. The Courier went out of business in 1982, so shortly after I came to Buffalo. But, you know, then there was like a long period where there would really be one dominant, one newspaper in most cities. And Minneapolis and the Minneapolis area has been, I think, is very fortunate in that it has had two continuing to exist papers. The Star Tribune is held up as an example of a very successful model. The St. Paul Pioneer Press, which of course has lots of good people and has done lots of good work, is nevertheless, if I'm not mistaken, owned by Alden Global. Yeah. And that's not the greatest owner. That's probably one of the worst owners these days.
Well, so, can we talk about Alden Global a little bit? Because I don't know, you know, for people who work in journalism, they've become basically the villain of local news.
Right. They're the dark
I think you prince. You referred to them as, quote, one of the most ruthless of the corporate strip miners, seemingly intent on destroying local journalism. Can you talk a little bit about Alden and
sure.
who they are, where they come from, and what do they do when they take over a paper?
Well, Alden Global is basically a hedge fund. And one of the things that it has invested in is still profitable newspapers that it buys up, and basically with the intention, apparent intention, of wringing the last profits out of these papers that have faded but are still around and are still making money because, you know, they still have a constituency. And so what Alden generally does is come into a city. Often it will sell off the real estate that's associated with the paper. I don't know if that's happened in St. Paul.
It has, yes. Yep. They had a downtown office there. I think it's sometimes referred to as the staff who are still there as one of the few benefits, as they moved into a much nicer space. But I mean, I think they had 8 floors previously and now they're condensed down to 1 floor.
Right. It's yeah. Yes. So they tend to sell off their big grand properties, which maybe isn't so terrible, but in some cases it's not great. And much worse is they quickly reduce the staff, the newsroom staff, the reporters, the editors, the photographers, the videographers, very radically. I mean, that is something you can do that isn't immediately visible to the consumer. You know, the paper still comes, or you still get it online. It's still called what it was called before. You still have content, but it's the content is diminished because journalism is a labor-intensive business. You need people. You need the people who will go to the meetings. You'll need the people who will dig into a scandal. You can't do it without people. And so when you cut the staff to the bone, you really hurt the journalism. So that is something that characterizes what happens when Alden Global buys up newspapers. And they now have bought up a lot of newspapers, including, for example, the Baltimore Sun, the Chicago Tribune, the Orlando Sentinel. I mean, some of these papers which have really proud histories and have been stalwart parts of their communities. And, you know, the Denver Post, the San Jose Mercury News. I mean, these were newspapers that really did tremendous work, and they probably still are doing some good work, but they can't do as much as they did before. They probably can't even do an adequate job once they're owned by, have an owner like Alden Global. So yeah. It's a really destructive force in our kind of media ecosystem as a whole.
Do you, I mean, the people behind Alden, I mean, I'm sure driven by money and profit and so forth. I mean, is it a, like I said, you know, it's easy to think of them as like the villains of the story of local news.
They are the villains.
Yeah.
They truly, I mean, it's like, it's not a stretch to say that. I'm sure that they might be people who are like nice to their families, but in terms of what their contributions are to the society or their effect on society, it's been pretty bad.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, and so, you know, you think about the, you know, as you talk about, they just really decimate these newsrooms as an example of the Pioneer Press. Alden has owned the Pioneer Press since 2010. In 2005, the Pioneer Press had 235 people in their newsroom. Now it's fewer than 40 people in their newsroom. You know, but even kind of beyond, you know, to see the loss of the number of journalists just doing that kind of coverage, can you talk about the impact of it? And you have your book that came out in 2020, Ghosting the News, local journalism and the crisis of American democracy. Can you talk about that second part a little bit? You know, how it impacts democracy, how it impacts just the health of communities to lose that kind of journalism.
So there's a pretty famous Yale professor, Timothy Snyder, and he wrote a book called On Tyranny. Mm-hmm. And he says that the loss of local news and local newspapers is the worst problem facing our democracy today. Well, why does he say that? Because what happens when local news withers, a few things happen. One of the things that happens is we lose our kind of, as communities, we lose our kind of common ground of truth and reality and factuality that people need in order to function as citizens. And people get driven more and more into their kind of polarized corners because they're on social media. You know, they're tending now to get their news through social media or word of mouth. They tend to be seeking out this kind of information that they like rather than maybe what's actually factual. And, you know, another thing that happens is, so people tend to vote much more along party line. They won't cross the aisle to vote. They become less actively and productively engaged in their communities. Like a lot of bad things happen when local news withers and goes away. And in some cases, places have become what academics call news deserts. There is no local news in some of these places because about 2,000 newspapers have gone out of business since, what's the date? Since 2004 to now, more than 2,000 papers have gone out of business. Now, some of them, a bunch of them were weeklies and some were dailies, but even when they were weeklies, they provided something important in those communities. And so it's really disturbing. And, you know, another thing that happens is, and this is hard to gauge, but politicians and office holders and corporations get away with stuff that they wouldn't get away with if there was more of a watchdog effect of these local newspapers or other news outlets there. I remember talking to this guy who was the publisher or the general manager of the Youngstown, Ohio Vindicator, which went out of business entirely. This was a daily, big city daily that went out of business. And he said, it was a very poignant moment. He said that he remembered a time when the Vindicator was healthy and big enough that they could send a reporter to pretty much any meeting that happened in a 3-county area. And he said that when the Vindicator reporters were in those meetings, that the office holders, the politicians and bureaucrats, whatever, they behaved, he said, because they knew we were watching. Mm-hmm. But that's no longer the case. It doesn't even exist anymore. So those are some of the kinds of things that eat away at our democracy. And, you know, I think everybody knows that right now we're in trouble as a country. We don't have a sort of common basis of truth and that you need to be a functioning democracy. And the loss of local news has really added to that, which is why, you know, again, Minneapolis is very, very lucky, I think, almost singularly lucky to have you guys, MinnPost, which you've been around for 15 years, and to have two two newspapers, and I'm sure you probably have public radio and TV stations. It's a pretty rich media environment compared to a lot of places.
Yeah. I'm kind of curious, you know, you talked about, you mentioned social media and people kind of getting into their own bubbles in social media. And obviously, you know, digital, social media, I mean, those have all impacted the business model, but I'm curious, do you have a sense of like the apathy of people or people, you know, this might be too depressing to bring up, but, you know, do people want that shared reality?
No, I mean, I think that people we have sort of found that people really do. I mean, just take cable news as an example. People go to cable news, whether it's Fox News or MSNBC, and I'm not really equating the two, but giving them as examples. They go to these networks to kind of get their outrage on. No, that's what they're for. That's what they're there for. To some extent, they inform as well. But they also, especially in the primetime evening shows, whether it's Tucker Carlson or Rachel Maddow, and again, I don't see these as equal. I think Fox is a really destructive force in our society. So I'm not making them equal, but giving examples. You know, they feed into that. That's how they get their viewers. And to some extent, that's true in all media. So, you know, yes, we should be eating broccoli, but we actually like hot fudge sundaes more, you know? And so there is that reality. But at the same time, I think as citizens and as news consumers, we really need to understand that we have to be well informed and to support news organizations that are informing them and to do the work of reading them or listening to them or watching them, whatever it may be, you know, because you can't be a functioning citizen of the democracy without doing that.
Well, so I'm kind of curious, you know, you talked about, you know, we often talk about the business model of journalism and, you know, like you said, here in Minnesota, we actually, I mean, comparatively have one of the healthiest and most robust media environments in the country. Yeah. You know, obviously I'll tout MinnPost all day long, and I will tell you, thank you for mentioning MinnPost favorably in your book. That's much appreciated. We also, I mean, we have other nonprofit entities like Sahan Journal, which is newer, in our ecosystem, but is rising quickly as a positive force here. The Star Tribune, I mean, the big story there is they're, I think you call it the local billionaire, club, where they've been, under ownership of Glenn Taylor since 2014, which has really stabilized them and helped them kind of adapt to the digital age much better than most other outlets. But, you know, beyond that business model, as we think about reimagining local news and maybe even think about in this context of not just the, you know, the competition of social media, the competition of not being focused on driving outrage to keep attention, but to think about insights and helping people understand what's going on in civic life. What do you think, or do you have examples of what you think local news could be different beyond the business model, but in the actual work that we do?
Right. Well, I think that, you know, the most important thing that local news can do and can be is to fulfill that accountability role, to do the watchdog work, do the enterprise, do the investigative work that is the kind of heart and soul of journalism. That, you know, we, of course, I love, you know, music reviews and book reviews and you know, human interest features. But if I had to pick one thing that I would want a news organization to do, it would be the accountability watchdog work that, you know, informs people about what their government and what their business leaders, what their school boards, et cetera, are doing. That's the most important thing that we can do, and that is the essence of local news. So the more of that, the better. And that's, I think, what a lot of, you know, I know that MinnPost does a lot of that. I know that, you know, Texas Tribune, which is another one of the encouraging, you know, bright spots out there of a place that has managed to, you know, hire more people and to really work, you know, they're doing a lot of statehouse coverage. I mean, one of the things that's really dried up across the country is is State House reporting. And State Houses is where a lot of really important stuff happens. And that is one of the places that used to be really well staffed and no longer is. So, but there are some good news there. Some places are putting together consortiums, or maybe it's consortia, but at any rate, groups of people, of news organizations that maybe in the past would have been competing against each other and now are cooperating to share their content to sort of, you know, find that strength in numbers. And there's one that comes to mind, which is Spotlight PA. So that involves, you know, Philadelphia and Pittsburgh and other cities in Pennsylvania that have gotten together to cover state government. And that, you know, that is really good to see. And it's great to see places doing some things that are collaborative instead of strictly competitive.
I want to, you know, you talk about Spotlight PA in your book as an example of, you know, collaborative effort and sharing resources and so forth. And I'm curious to talk about maybe a few of the other sort of, I think you call them beacons of hope. One is East Lansing Info, which I'm familiar with. They have, they're members of the Institute of Nonprofit News, as is MinnPost. And they kind of, well, I'll let you, can you talk a little bit about them and what their model is?
They're very unusual. I mean, I guess the kind of umbrella term would be called citizen journalism. But basically they have a, you know, quite a visionary founder, Alice Dregner, who, you know, she's not a journalist by background, but she started up this thing feeling that there just wasn't, there was coverage of Lansing, but not of East Lansing. And so, you know, she thought that there could be some really rich stories there. And she basically recruited, you know, retirees, people who were homebound in one way or another, or just didn't have like a pressing full-time job, and sort of trained them to be journalists. And I think she calls it, you know, the news brigade or something. And what she told me is, you know, these people don't make a lot of money. They are not going to come in and make $50,000 a year or whatever. They're going to be paid by the piece probably, or it's just not a lot. But because they're interested, because they're public-spirited, they're able to actually do some pretty good coverage, and they've turned up a lot of great stories. So is that a model that could work in a lot of different places? I asked her that, and she said, well, maybe not, because not everybody has the same interest or you know, kind of proclivities that she has. But she said there could be other models that are different but also effective, you know. So it's a very inventive one. And I think it actually could be duplicated, but maybe it isn't. I mean, I don't think it's as much of a model as MinnPost is, which could actually exist with the proper support and leadership in a lot of different communities. I'm not sure East Lansing Info could be that. I mean, maybe it could. I would love to see it happen.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's one of the interesting, I mean, looking at INN, looking at now American Journalism Project coming in to, you know, funding local news and so forth, all of the different examples, and that no one of them, it's not a silver bullet. You know, there's no one that will work in every market. You know, it kind of has to be catered to the locality a little bit.
Right. And I think that's true. Even if you look at the whole big picture of local news and kind of how to fix it, is there isn't actually no single answer, and that the whole thing has to be like a piecemeal, kind of a patchwork of different answers, different ways of addressing the problem that, you know, hopefully if you put them all together, they sort of begin to fill in the gaps. And, you know, and I want to be clear that I don't mean to say that newspapers like the one I worked at for so long necessarily did such a great job all the time. I mean, for one thing, we didn't really, a lot of establishment newspapers did not do a very good job of covering all the diversity of their communities. They tended to cover sort of, you know, government, bureaucracy, the rich and powerful, not necessarily the poorer, members of their community and those kinds of problems, the communities of color, like a lot of that was neglected, and that's not good. So this should not be some sort of nostalgia trip that I want to go back to the 1980s or something like that. I think we really actually need to reinvent ourselves and are doing so, but it's very, very uncomfortable and dangerous in a way too.
Yeah. One other example, I mean, really caught my eye reading your book. I was not familiar with them, was community impact in, I think, is it Pflugerville? Is that how you pronounce it?
Texas,
Pflugerville,
yes. Texas. Texas. Can you talk a little,
yeah. Can you talk a little bit about them?
They're interesting. They are, you know, they're very print focused, which is very unusual to hear someone talk about the value and the sustainability of print. But they go after print advertisers. They give the paper away for free, but they, you know, it's not a penny saver. It's they actually have, you know, paid reporters. They are in a bunch of different cities and communities all over the United States, and they're doing pretty well. And John Garrett, who is the CEO and the founder, you know, he really thinks that there's a constituency for print that has been kind of diminished and shunted aside. And he thinks that that there's something there, especially if you can target advertising so that it can even approach the targeting that advertisers can get on social media, because that is such a huge appeal. But if you can, and you can offer that to them, then he says the advertisers come and the readers are there because they send this printed product out to them. And you know, they're paying people and they've hired people, and it seems to be an interesting model. So certainly worth paying some attention to.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I want to shift gears here a little bit. Before I do, though, I want to remind people you can submit your questions for Margaret using Q&A button at the bottom of your window. Drop them in there. We'll be getting to them in a little bit. But yeah, I wanted to shift gears. You have a new book coming out this fall, a memoir, Newsroom Confidential, Lessons and Worries from an Ink-Stained Life. Now, I don't want to get into touchy territory in terms of talking about the length of your career, but from my count, it's a 42-year career. You've said, though, that about a third of the book covers the 4 years you were public editor at the New York Times. So I sense there might be some juicy previews you could share with us, but I'm kind of curious, you know, what is it like being the public editor of the New York Times? I mean, is it hard? Do people eat lunch with you? Is it like, what's that vibe like?
So let me describe, first of all, for people who might not know what it is, it's the equivalent of an ombudsman or an ombudswoman. So I was the reader representative and kind of an internal critic of the Times. This is a role that the Times started after they had a scandal in which a reporter, Jason Blair, made stuff up and plagiarized, and they decided that they needed to have someone internally who could bring this kind of thing to the fore before it became a huge problem. They wanted there to be an internal watchdog. So they would hire an experienced reporter, an editor, such as myself. And I came there in 2012. And it was a really intense experience. I mean, it was not particularly comfortable. In fact, I have a line that's gotten pulled out into a little promotional animation that is sort of fun, that says, in my 4 years on the job, I never had a completely comfortable day as public editor of the New York Times. And the reason for that is that you're there at work and you're basically keeping an eye on what amounts to your colleagues. And I guess it's a little bit like internal affairs, or like being the inspector general of a big government department. So you have to have a lot of self-confidence and a lot of belief in your own judgment, which I did. I mean, I had been the editor of a newspaper, a sizable newspaper, for 12 years. I had gotten, you know, done everything from dealt with plagiarism to lawsuits to, you know, union problems to big stories. And so I felt like I was pretty confident. But, you know, at the same time, you're at the New York Times, which is so dominant and where people feel that they are at the top of the heap. And it was very uncomfortable to surface the reader's objections and then to take those to the editors or reporters, get response, and then write about it in the very pages of the New York Times, or, you know, pages, I'm using that metaphorically. Most of the time I was writing on a blog called the Public Editor's Journal. And I wrote blog posts probably 3 or 4 times a week. So like anything that came up that was making people crazy, whether it was an obituary or whether it was the coverage of the Middle East, I would bring it up and treat it in this way. And, you know, it was a fantastic opportunity for me. It certainly broadened my view and put me at the Times, which is so singular in its influence. And I don't regret doing it, but I was happy to lay that burden down when the time came.
Again, preview maybe of your book a little bit, increase people's appetite. Any specific examples or experiences that stood out there?
One of the crazy things that happened when I was there, and people may remember this, was that the first woman editor of the Times, Jill Abramson, was fired while I was there. Mm-hmm. And it was really, you know, it had been such a huge deal for a woman to be named the editor of the New York Times. And she had only been in that job for about 2.5 years. And she was fired very suddenly. And it was a shocker. And, you know, she said at the time that she felt it had to do, at least in part, with a pay equity issue. And, you know, the Times itself was denying that and said it was her management abilities. And of course, at that time, she was then replaced by Dean Baquet, who was the first Black editor, the first editor of color of the New York Times. So there's just a lot of high drama around this whole thing, a lot of coverage from the outside, a lot of angst and reaction and, you know, high emotion on the inside. And so I was there for that, and I write a lot about that. And, you know, as the first woman editor of my paper in Buffalo, I certainly sympathized with her and identified with her. And at the same time, I think she would even say that she, you know, she wasn't the greatest manager and that she had her flaws. And so, you know, I analyzed that. I analyzed it at the time, and I get to it in my book as well.
Not necessarily about those specific people, but, you know, so, you know, you talked about like sort of being like internal affairs there in the office and, yeah, and everything. Are you friends with these people outside of the office? Do you set that aside, or, you know, how do you balance those roles?
During the time when I was on the job as public editor, I might have even written this in my upcoming book, which is called Newsroom Confidential. You can pre-order it. I think I remember saying I was really glad that I had a lot of friends already, because I wasn't really able to, you know, it wouldn't really have even been appropriate for me to make close friends at the paper, which is a weird thing, because when you're in a newsroom, you know, it tends to be a very social environment, and you do tend to socialize with people. And I did a little bit, but I felt like I had to restrain that, and they didn't really want to socialize with me anyway. But I have, you know, what if they said something that I would then report on? But I have found that since I left in 2016, that I have maintained relationships with some of the people there, and some of them I do consider friends. So all's well that ends well, but, you know, it wasn't like a great way to make a lot of new friends, probably one of the worst ways to do that.
I'm sure you were very well liked all the same.
In general, I think.
And respected. Yes. So I want to get into some audience questions here. There's a question from Susan. I'm going to just read directly what she submitted. The largest legacy political news desks seem mealy-mouthed in their reporting on decidedly anti-democratic actions by some elected Republicans to overturn the 2020 election and then to cover up and rationalize those actions. Legacy newsrooms can impact the news agenda for the nation to some degree. You know, why are they maybe acting so timidly or you know, not taking sort of a more forthright stand? I mean, I think it's an interesting question in terms of, you know, newsrooms not being biased, but we do seemingly have a bias toward democracy.
I think Susan's question is, you know, she's going to the heart of the most important question for political journalism and maybe journalism overall that we have. And I would say not only in the United States, but in the world. So way to go, Susan. I think that news organizations always want, they desperately want to be seen as fair. They're afraid of being attacked by the right. It's very uncomfortable to be attacked by the right. There are, you know, a lot of people on the extreme or radical right are very good at going after people. So you don't want that. You want to maximize your audience. And so as a result, there's a tendency to want to take everything down the middle. Maybe if we treat it, you know, exactly equally, nobody will be mad at us and we can maximize our audience. The problem with that is that the two sides are not really equal anymore. If they ever, they probably were much more equal. They're not anymore. I mean, we actually have a party now that has been radicalized, and many members, many elected and appointed members of which are not interested in keeping the guardrails of democracy upright. So, you know, as journalists, we have to deal with reality and not with what we wish was reality. So I think that's the reason for this kind of, she describes it as mealy-mouthedness, timidity, or kind of a forced or performative neutrality that doesn't actually reflect what's happening. So I would say that I was really pleased recently when the Washington Post formed a new desk within the newsroom, a new group of reporters and editors called the Democracy Desk, because their whole purpose is going to be to aggressively report on these threats to democracy. And I think just by labeling it that way and by centering it in that way, I think it's really, I find it to be very heartening. I mean, I'm not in a decision-making role at the Washington Post, so I found out about it like everybody else did, but I thought it was great. And I give our new editor, Sally Busby, a lot of credit for the kind of vision that she's showing in doing that. So so I agree with you, Susan, and that's why I think it's happening.
Can you, wrote a column on, you mentioned, you know, Jill Abramson to Dean Becquet, but now Dean Becquet is leaving the executive editor role and they've named Joe Kahn as his successor, taking over in I think a little over a month or so. You're pretty bullish on him taking the reins of the Times. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, when I was at the Times as public editor, Joe Kahn was supervising international news. And the thing that I wrote my column about and that I really appreciated about him was that I found him to be pretty non-defensive and pretty open to what the readership had to say and pretty open to criticism. So that's, I think, an important quality. Not that you take on every bit of criticism and agree with it and adjust, but just that kind of openness is actually relatively rare at the top of a lot of news organizations, including, you know, some of the biggest ones. It's you're under attack all the time. And so you get kind of defensive and there's a tendency to sort of circle the wagons. And I guess I wanted to recognize or tout in him that he was a little bit unusual in that he seemed to be able to hear the criticism better than most people. So, I mean, I also appreciate that he was a China correspondent for the New York Times, and a lot of his work had to do with pointing out abuses and inequities in how Chinese people were treated in factories or in other ways. So he seems to have a feel for the underprivileged, the common person, and I like that too. So, you know, who knows? He may turn out to be, I think he has the ability to be a really fine editor. He's a really smart guy. And I suppose in a way I was trying to underscore and encourage the qualities that I hope he will play to, because I think he has the ability to play to them.
We have an audience question here from Jane, and I'm going to condense this a little bit and actually maybe tie it back to the local level. So, you know, one big part of the Trump era was sort of villainizing the press and journalists and reporters, you know, the enemies of the people. You know, even that sort of broad anti-journalism, anti-press sentiment. I'm kind of curious, have you seen that at the local level? I mean, because that's something where, you know, particularly in a smaller community, you know, you might know the people who are working at the paper and so forth. Yeah, I mean, how have you seen that manifest?
No, it has absolutely made its way. It's made its way both to the local level where, for example, a TV crew will go out to cover a school board meeting and get attacked as being fake news and being driven out of the meeting or, you know, abused in some way. I mean, that is one way that it's come from sort of the national political level to the local. And on the other hand, it's also been mimicked on the world stage where would-be autocrats or autocrats have adopted this phrase that Trump popularized, fake news, and are using that. I mean, even Putin recently, when he criminalized the act of journalism in Russia, said that it was fake news that was going to be punished. And his definition of fake news had to do with calling the Russian invasion of Ukraine, calling it a war or calling it an invasion. Well, it is a war and it is an invasion. So there's nothing fake about that. But the sort of the taking on of this insult, and as you put it, or the questioner puts it, the villainization is really troubling. I mean, I happen to think that journalism is a really high calling and it's really a noble thing. It's a really necessary thing. And it hurts me to see it diminished and disparaged so much. And I think it's bad for democracy as well, because we really need to be able to do our job and not be harassed and, you know, arrested and thrown in jail and all of those things. So it's a really troubling development that has gotten a lot worse in the past 5 years.
I'm going to pair up, this is a question I have, I think it'll be the last question we have time for, but I'm going to pair it up with a question from an audience member, Sandy. Sandy asked about, you know, looking forward, how do you see the profession 15 years from now? But, you know, a question I had was CNN Plus, their digital stream, you know, started less than a month ago and is now, you know, being shuttered. They'd invested, you know, reportedly up to $350 million to create CNN Plus in this digital channel. They brought in, you know, a lot of talent and so forth, and now closing it down. You know, $350 million in context, that would fund MinnPost at our current level for 184 years. I believe the entirety of INN news membership, I think, is $355 million a year. I mean, so it's quite a bit of money in terms of the scale of where an organization like we are. You know, thinking out into the future, if you had that $350 million to invest in local news, what would you do? How would you invest it?
Right. Well, I definitely would not have used it to start CNN Plus because, I mean, that's a weird, you know, the whole idea of it, which was give us more money to watch more cable news, like the outtakes of cable news, basically. I don't know. You know, I think it was a little misconceived to begin with. But yeah, if I had unlimited or almost unlimited amounts of money to spend on local on news, I would spend it on reporting. You know, the lifeblood, the heart and soul of local journalism is the people doing the reporting. Yes, you need great editors. You need great visual people, audio people. I don't diminish any of that, but I think I would concentrate on the digging and the presence that that is so important and that's been so diminished, like in a newsroom that you described that used to have 200, 250 people in it and now is down into the, 40 people or something like that, which is very, very common. That is not just St. Paul. That has happened across the country. So, that's where I would put the money if I had that much.
I'm kind of curious, I mentioned American Journalism Project. If people aren't familiar with it, it's Elizabeth Green, who founded this nonprofit news organization, Chalkbeat, and John Thornton, founder and kind of the financial force behind the Texas Tribune, have started this, I think they call it venture philanthropy for local news. Now, their model is to focus it into revenue generation. For audience generation for local news organizations with the idea that it needs more runway. Do you think that's a mistake? I mean, that's kind of a little bit different than what you would do at that kind of scale.
I mean, I think their aim would be the same though, which is that they're trying to fund the journalism, but they're looking at it from a revenue perspective. You have to, you have to have a functional organization that's capable of generating revenue to pay for the journalists. Yeah. So it's not revenue for its own sake. It's revenue for the journalism. And I like the American Journalism Project. I like those people a lot. And I think they're raising good amounts of money and they're getting it out into communities. And it's one piece, maybe this is a way to conclude, it's one piece of the puzzle of solving like the sort of local news puzzle. I think that's one decent sized piece of it. Mm-hmm. So it's good.
Yeah. All right. Well, on that, I guess, somewhat hopeful note, we'll wrap up. Really appreciate your time and insights today, Margaret. It's a real pleasure talking to you and having you here for the festival. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Thanks for having me and best of luck to MinnPost. I'm a fan.
Thank you. And do you want to put one last plug in for your book, Newsroom Confidential?
Newsroom Confidential. It is available, as they say, wherever books are sold. And for whatever reason, I don't understand this, but pre-orders seem to be such a big deal in the book world. So if anybody's inclined to pre-order Newsroom Confidential, that'd be great. No pressure.
Wonderful. Okay. Well, and maybe when you're out promoting the book, you can come back and we can talk some more.
Yeah. All right. Good.
All right. Thank you so much, thank Margaret.
You. Bye.
And with that, I also want to thank our festival sponsors, our VIP supporters, and of course, all of our MinnPost members. Again, you can be a MinnPost member with a donation of any amount at minnpost.com/support. Thank you all for being here and thank you for your great questions. We didn't have time to get to all of them, but really appreciate it. For the festival, we'll be back again tomorrow morning at 9:30 a.m. Central with Minnesota House Speaker Melissa Hortman and Minnesota Senate Majority Leader Jeremy Miller in a conversation moderated by Peter Callahan, and then 11:30 a.m. with Lieutenant Governor Peggy Flanagan moderated by Walker Orenstein. So we hope you will join us for those sessions. Until then, have a good rest of your day and we'll see you soon. Thanks.